Good morning. Today we are going to use calculus to derive the work energy theorem. And I do understand, because this is an algebra-based class, that many of you have not taken calculus yet. However, I consider it important to sometimes see math, which is a little bit more advanced than what you currently understand.
Thank you.
Flippin' physics.
The definition of work using calculus is: work equals the integral from the initial position to the final position of force with respect to position. So, this big curve here means the integral. Below and above the integral are the limits. So, from position initial to position final of force, and dx means with respect to x or with respect to position. In other words, work is equal to the integral from initial position to final position of force with respect to position. However, we want to use net work, which means when we replace work with net work, we also need to replace force with net force. Bo, what is Newton's second law?
Net force equals mass times acceleration, where both force and acceleration are vectors.
Correct, which means we can replace the net force with mass times acceleration. Notice I've dropped the vector symbol on acceleration. That is because everything here is in the x direction, so we do not need that vector symbol. Mass is a scalar, so we can take it out from underneath the integral. Now, we cannot integrate, we cannot take the integral yet, because we're trying to take the integral with respect to position, and acceleration does not have position in it. Bobby, what is the equation for acceleration?
Acceleration equals change in velocity over change in time.
True. However, because we are using calculus today, we need to use the calculus definition of instantaneous acceleration. Acceleration equals the derivative of velocity with respect to time. dv divided by dt means the derivative of velocity with respect to time. We can substitute the derivative of velocity with respect to time in for acceleration. However, we are still unable to take the integral. So let's take a closer look at this derivative of velocity with respect to time. The derivative of velocity with respect to time is the same thing as the derivative of velocity with respect to position times the derivative of position with respect to time. Notice how the dx's cancel out, and we're left with the derivative of velocity with respect to time. Therefore, we can substitute in the derivative of velocity with respect to position times the derivative of position with respect to time in for the derivative of velocity with respect to time. These two dx's cancel one another out, and we are left with net work equals mass times the integral with respect to velocity of the derivative of position with respect to time. And notice what we need to do to our limits, because we've changed what we're taking the integral with respect to. We were taking the integral with respect to position, so we went from position initial to position final. But now, because we're taking the integral with respect to velocity, our limits have changed. We're taking the integral from velocity initial to velocity final. And we are almost there. We can almost take the integral. Billy, what is the equation for velocity?
Velocity is change in position over change in time. However, I bet you are going to say we need the calculus version of instantaneous velocity, which is probably the derivative of position with respect to time.
Correct. We need instantaneous velocity equals the derivative of position with respect to time, because then we can substitute velocity in for the derivative of position as a function of time. And now we can finally take the integral. The integral of velocity with respect to velocity is velocity squared divided by 2, and we retain those limits from initial velocity to the final velocity, and we can now plug in those limits. Net work equals 1/2 times mass times velocity final squared minus 1/2 times mass times velocity initial squared. which is where 1/2 times mass times velocity squared comes from. We give it a special name, which is what, class?
Kinetic energy.
And it becomes net work equals kinetic energy final minus kinetic energy initial, which is the change in kinetic energy. Therefore, the net work done by all the forces acting on an object causes a change in kinetic energy of that object, the work-energy theorem. Basically, all the forces acting on an object, the net force, will do work on that object, the net work, which will cause a change in kinetic energy of that object, a change in velocity of that object, the work-energy theorem.
Hey, wait a minute. That looks just like the work due to friction equals change in mechanical energy equation.
Bo, that is a good point. Thank you for mentioning that. Notice how similar these two equations are. The work due to friction equals the change in mechanical energy, and the net work equals change in kinetic energy. Both of them have work on the left-hand side and change in energy on the right-hand side. And students often confuse the two, which is why I prefer not to call this just the work-energy theorem, but rather the net work kinetic energy theorem. One of our other energy equations is conservation of mechanical energy. Conservation of mechanical energy is true when the work done by friction is equal to zero and the work done by a force applied on the object is equal to zero. Work due to friction equals change in mechanical energy is true when the work done by the force applied at an object is equal to zero. Now, class, what did we have to assume when we proved the net work kinetic energy theorem?
Nothing. I don't think we made any assumptions.
Penguins?
Correct. We did not need to make any special assumptions when proving the net work equals the change in kinetic energy, because the net work kinetic energy theorem is always true. And unlike other alwayses which aren't quite always true, this one is always true. The net work done by all the forces acting on an object is always equal to the change in kinetic energy of that object. Oh, and because the net work kinetic energy theorem has kinetic energy final and kinetic energy initial in it, you must identify the locations of your initial and final points. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.
I want my $2.